Every morning I come in here, this is my ritual. I come in over to this Robert's radio here, but before I turn the radio on, I pick up this. I've got this in Japan, and I ring my Buddhist bell, and I look into it, and inside, if you look up to the light, you see Avalokiteshvara floating in the sky. And I'll do a few on Mani Padme Hum, because that's my sadhana. On Mani Padme Hum, and ring the bell. And then I'm here at work, you see.
Being a Buddhist and being an artist were two ways of dropping out of society for me. They were alternative versions of how you live. They're a way of engaging with life, the meaning of life. You know, what are we? Why are we here? What are we doing? What can we do? What are the possibilities? It's also counterculture. You look at human history and you look at the Buddha pops up. He was a true revolutionary. He changed everything. When I looked at Western culture, I thought, well, what's the most meaningful thing? I thought, art is what the best of humans do. Painting was the one that I could do. The meeting point was meditation and drawing, for instance. They are concentration practices. They have an immediacy, a focus. So when I'm here at the studio, like 6 hours or whatever, I'm pretty concentrated. Like, my paintings are very detailed, they're very slow. And so I have to sustain concentration.
Kuan Yin in the corner there, which was my dad's, and next to it is a brass stupa in which is my dad's ashes. So, and my portrait of my dead dad is over there in the corner. So that's all part of the context of the Buddha, my dad's ashes, Kuan Yin, Avalokiteshvara. They're all here. There's another Avalokiteshvara over there.
When I was on my master's, I'd been trained in life painting, like painting from life models. But after my dad died and I painted his corpse, you know, the life model becomes an object as a corpse. So it becomes a still life. And so I started painting all these still lives as a response to my dad's death and my own mortality. So I was hyper aware of my own mortality. I was painting these still lives and the newspaper clippings. You know, all those death images and war and so forth, the representations of death, mortality, impermanence and so on. And the obituaries in particular, that's exactly what they are. But when I started painting obituaries, almost immediately I was having shows. Very good art critics were writing about the obituaries. They caught the imagination of some people, wanted to show them, buy them, own them. I'm just trying to make beautiful objects, really. I try my very best with each and every one of them to do the best I can with it. Every painting is a reflection of my own mortality, especially these artists and their self-portraits, how they represented themselves. They're looking at themselves, they're looking at their own mortality, and I'm doing it, I'm engaging it. It's such a weird and complex practice to remake somebody else's self-portrait, and they're staring at themselves and therefore they're staring at me. So I'm painting Kathy Kollowitz here. She's staring at me. I'm fully engaged with her image of herself. You know, she's long dead, but it's very much, yeah, I'm going for refuge. I'm contemplating my own mortality. I love oil painting. I'm completely obsessed with it. There's so much to it. After 30 or 40 years of working with oil paint, I'm still exploring and finding out new things about it. It's physical action, you know, painting. But when I teach meditation, I also say the same thing. It's physical action. Our mind is in the body. Our body's in the mind. You know, it's the same thing in painting and in meditating. It's all there. I love it. I just love it. I love thinking about the Buddha teaching this stuff, sitting amongst the trees.
He embodies the epitome of humanity, I suppose. And an artist at their best touches on that, maybe.